In this video, we're going to be doing a quick overview, a very, very basic overview of the major dietary macronutrients. Just right before we talk about the macronutrients, I just want to mention the idea of micronutrients, because you shouldn't learn macronutrients without being aware of micronutrients. Micronutrients are those various nutrients that we need in very small quantities, where macronutrients are the nutrients we need in very large quantities. So when we think micronutrients, you should be thinking vitamins and minerals mostly. With macronutrients, we are talking about water, carbohydrates, fat, and protein. Water is actually the macronutrient that we need the most of. People oftentimes don't think of water as a macronutrient because it doesn't have calories in it, but we do need a lot of water in our diet. There are consequences to hypohydration, which is the term for having not enough water in our body, essentially. Oftentimes, people use the term dehydration to mean the same thing. It takes about a 2% drop in our body water in order for our thirst mechanism to engage for most individuals. So if you only lose 1% or 1.5%, you're probably not going to feel thirsty. So for exercise reasons, your thirst may or may not always be the best mechanism to go by in order to make sure that you're maintaining proper hydration in order to maintain your performance. And the reason for that is once you're at 3 to 4% of water loss, you're now going to start having exercise performance decrements. So your exercise performance is going to get worse. And the more you lose, the worse that exercise performance is going to become. And of course, if you lose too much water, you can start running into issues, health-based issues, and it can also increase the likelihood of various heat illnesses like heat stroke, which can be deadly. The adequate intake for water for women is about 2.7 liters per day. For men, it's 3.7 liters per day. This is an adequate intake recommendation. This is not the best recommendation that we potentially have. There's not enough sort of evidence to give a specific number to this, because the water needs of people vary quite a bit from person to person and from one situation to another. You know, think of somebody in a hotter environment or a more dry, arid environment versus somebody in a more humid environment or a more temperate environment. All those different situations are going to change how much water you need. If you are exercising in a hot environment, especially if it's a hot, humid environment, you're going to have a much greater need for water because you're going to be sweating a lot. And the sweat is the primary way we lose body water. And so it's very easy for you to lose, you know, 7 or more liters per day of water if you are exercising or working in hot environments. And so this 2.7 and 3.7 liters per day, that's the general recommendation, would not be sufficient for somebody who is working or exercising in hot environments. Some common sources of water would be obviously our beverages, so the drinks we have. On average, people bring in about 1.5 liters per day as a drink. Solid foods do have some water in them, so about 0.75 liters per day, so 3/4 of a liter per day is commonly brought in through food. And then our metabolic processes, so a lot of our processes that actually create energy within our bodies, or bioenergetic processes, can make water. And so we should be expecting to get around 1/4, so 0.25 liters per day from our various bioenergetic processes. So I'll actually put a link below this to the playlist that I already have on bioenergetic processes. So you can watch that sort of lecture series if you want. Anyway, so these are sort of fairly typical levels. Obviously, these levels need to change if someone's exercising and sweating a lot, or living or working in hot environments where they're sweating a lot. And so the primary way it's going to change, though, is through drinking water. So the beverages is the one that's most likely to go up quite a bit in those situations. Carbohydrates is the macronutrient we need the most of after water. Carbohydrate also is one of the three macronutrients. So most of them, macronutrients that have calories in them. So we get about 4.1 kilocalories per gram of carbohydrates that we eat and consume. Carbohydrates has a distinction where we need these carbohydrates in order to fuel the brain in the central nervous system. So that includes the spinal cord. Except in some special dietary situations or in people who have a low carbohydrate diet for various reasons, whether it's by choice or for clinical reasons, excluding those people, the brain exclusively uses carbohydrates for its fuel source. Again, excluding low carbohydrate intake diets. So in a normal diet, the brain uses about 130 grams per day of glucose, which is the primary carbohydrate that our body uses. So that's about 533 calories or kilocalories per day that the brain and the spinal cord uses just in order to maintain the normal neurological processes that we use. The general recommendation for carbohydrates is to bring in between 45 and 65% of our total calories in carbohydrates. And so this is going to have more specific recommendations for athletes, where it's going to be between 3 and 12 grams of carbohydrates per kilogram of body mass per day. There's quite a bit of range in this value because it's going to be different based on how much energy the person's using is in their athletics or exercise, and also are they coming up to an event where they need to have a lot of glycogen stores. If so, they're probably going to eat on the higher end of this. I should mention here that dietary fiber, because it's non-digestible, does not have calories that our bodies are able to liberate, and so it is not included in the calories that you see on a dietary label, and so you actually have to subtract out the dietary fiber from the total carbohydrates in order to figure out how many calories are coming from carbohydrates on a dietary label. After carbohydrates, the next macronutrient that we need in the highest quantity is going to be fats. So we need 20 to 25% of our total calories to come from fat. And so fat is really great because it's our a great way of getting energy into our body, and it's our primary energy source for rest as well as low intensity exercise. And we get about 9.4 kilocalories per gram of fat that we consume liberated in our body. A quick health note of talking about fats here is not all fats are the same. So diets that are rich in dietary cholesterol, saturated fats, and trans fats are going to increase our low-density lipoproteins or LDL cholesterol within our blood, and that increases the risk of cardiovascular disease. And so generally it's recommended that we try to limit how much of these types of fats that we're consuming. The macronutrient that we actually need the least of, even though you might think otherwise if you look at some of the things in pop culture these days, talking about diets, is it's actually protein. We need less protein than we need carbohydrates and fats. And the primary reason for this is it's not a source of energy our body wants to use. Can use it for energy, and when it does, we get about 4.1 kilocalories of energy per gram that we consume. But again, we don't want to use protein as an energy source. When we use protein as an energy source, we often are pulling that out of our skeletal muscle, which means we're going to deteriorate our muscles and organs, because that's the only reservoir for protein our bodies have, unlike carbohydrates and fats, which can be stored and used later on for energy. All right, so what are the health-based recommendations for protein consumption? 0.8 grams of protein per kilogram of body mass is the general recommendation for most Americans in order to maintain appropriate diets for health. There are some sport-specific recommendations for protein, though. So for general athletes that are exercising intensely, so this is only for athletes that exercise intensely, otherwise they should be using the general health recommendations. But for intensely exercising athletes, 1.2 to 1.7 grams of protein per kilogram of body mass per day is the recommendation. If the exercise is intense and long, so think like long distance cycling, long distance running, the recommendation is 1.2 to 1.7 grams per kilogram of body mass per day. Main reason being those endurance-based athletes tend to use a little bit more protein for fuel. The longer the exercise, the more likely they're going to be using protein as a supplemental fuel. It's still not the primary. It's not even close to being a primary energy source, but we use a little bit more of it if we exercise for long durations. the people who do intense and new, specifically new resistance exercise, also need an elevated amount of protein, and they're on this sort of higher range of the 1.2 to 1.7, so 1.6 to 1.7 grams of protein per kilogram of body mass per day is a recommendation for people who are doing intense and new resistance exercise. So if you're doing the same resistance plan you've been doing for 6 months, you probably don't need to be in this range. You can be in the lower range for athletes if it's intense. If it's not so intense, you should be using the health-based recommendations of 0.8 grams per kilogram of body mass. All right, so there are some people who recommend well above this range. The evidence does not show any real improvements in skeletal muscle building if you go above 2 grams of protein per kilogram body mass per day. So going above 2, you'll see sometimes people recommending all the way up to about 3 grams of protein per kilogram of body mass per day, but the evidence that I'm aware of does not support going above 2 grams per day, and really you probably don't need to go above this 1.6 to 1.7 grams per kilogram of body mass per day in order to build muscle mass. This is probably sufficient for doing that still. In this video, we talked about macronutrients and gave some general recommendations for macronutrients. We're going to talk about some various terminology that you should be aware of when thinking about your diets and looking at the recommendations from the government for your diet, which is a lot of what I showed in this video. So I'm going to put a link in the description below this video for the video that I make talking about some of those other terminology and various terms and sources of information that you should be aware of.